We're in Inwood Hill Park in northern Manhattan in the very end of May, and it's a beautiful spring day, and we're going to be looking at plants in the forest today. As you can see, Inwood is part of a really vibrant neighborhood. There's a lot of recreational facilities around. It's in the middle of a densely populated neighborhood. But here we have trees that are really old. Here's a really old black oak. And we're going to see a lot of big old trees as we walk through the woods. So already we have a bunch of cool plants all together before we've even gotten up into the woods. So I thought I'd stop and check these out. First, we have sassafras. Sassafras is a native tree, and it is one of the food sources for spice bush swallowtail caterpillars. And there are these really cool caterpillars that have eye spots on them, and they turn into these beautiful butterflies. The neat thing about sassafras is that it has polymorphic leaves, which means that the leaves come in different shapes. So let's see what we can find. We've got one leaf shape, which is just an oval. It's not very interesting. But then the other one is shaped like a mitten, and there's one here. And then the ones towards the end, you can see here, they're trilobed. There's three. So that's pretty cool. Another thing about them is that the leaves smell amazing. They have such a nice scent. And the fruits of this tree are really high in fats, and they're really good for migratory songbirds in the fall. So they're a really important food source. And the tree turns gorgeous shades of red. The leaves are astoundingly beautiful. Something else that turns really pretty colors in the fall is this woody shrub here, which is a little bit hard to see. I'm going to kind of pull on it. It grows up trees. It also grows along the ground. This is Virginia creeper. And leaves of three, let it be, right? But this is leaves of five. We will super duper see poison ivy. But right now, this is Virginia creeper. This is another native vine. It's a woody vine. It's divided into five different parts. And this also has berries that in the fall are good for migrating songbirds to eat because they're high in fat. They give them a lot of energy. And this turns this gorgeous shade of red. It's crimson. It's really incredible. And something else that's also a woody vine but is kind of a bummer is this here. So I'm going to pull it because it's invasive, is this. So this is Japanese honeysuckle, and you can see that the leaves are opposite and it just grows, and then it's got this funky lobe thing going on here too. But there's tons of it through here. And it's invasive because what it's doing is smothering out other things that are growing here, and it grows in such a way that it doesn't allow for, it's not a very good neighbor. It doesn't allow for other plants to grow along with it. And as the name implies, it's from Japan, it's Asian. And because it's left a lot of the diseases and caterpillars and bugs and things that would eat it behind, when it comes here, it grows unchecked. So that's one of the things about invasive plants that becomes really problematic. And so let's keep walking and see what we see. So leaves of three, let them be. Here we have them. This is poison ivy growing straight up a tree. And this is the way you're used to seeing this. It's a woody vine, and people hate it because it makes you really itchy, of course, when you touch it. But the interesting thing about poison ivy is that it's native. So it has relationships with plants and animals that live here. There are a number of things that pollinate the flowers, believe it or not. But one of the most important things about this plant is that it, again, has really high quality fruits, waxy berries, that migratory birds eat in the fall. So in that sense, it's a really important plant. Just don't touch it. And we actually walked by a bunch of it coming up here that was growing off over onto the trail as a ground cover. So poison ivy also grows just straight up out of the ground and can look like a shrub. So as you're walking in the woods, you always just want to be really aware of poison ivy. Don't just reach out and grab something. Make sure you know what it is first before you touch it. Here we have an area that's been burned fairly recently. A couple years ago, Huey and I were coming in here to do a series for the New York Times about Inwood Hill Park, and we'd come once a week. And this is one of the places that we took photographs. We took pictures of this red maple that was that were printed in the paper. And so here, you can, this looks different than the way it was the last time we were here, which is maybe a couple years ago. And it's just an issue with human use. People come into the park and, you know, everyone has a different agenda when they come into the park. So it's really hard to keep natural areas in a state where nature conservation is always the goal because there's so many different park users. Just adjacent to the burned area, we were walking along and found a shrub and flower. So I ran over and it looks like a blueberry, but it's not. So this is a vaccinium, which is the same genus as blueberries, but blueberries flowered already. They flower in April. So what the heck is this thing flowering now? This is maleberry. This is vaccinium stemmium. And this is actually a city rare plant. You can see the flowers here. They don't look like blueberry flowers at all. Blueberry flowers look like bells, and these are clearly five-petaled and more open. And these don't have edible fruits on them as blueberries do. They're just sort of dry capsules. But what makes this plant so cool is that it's a city rare plant. Typically, you find it growing in dry oak woods, which is where we are. And according to my notes, this hasn't been seen in the borough of Manhattan before. Oops, this is a place I've walked by 1,000 times and I think I just looked over and was like, oh yeah, that's, you know, high bush blueberry, but it's definitely not. So this is a really exciting, fun thing to find, and you're the first to see it. So there are those really pretty white flowers dangling underneath. These flowers, this is obviously flowering now, and this is the very end of May. Blueberries flower in April, so the flowering time is really different. And these also look really different from blueberry flowers. Those are bell-shaped, and so the reproductive parts of the flower are more hidden. And these are much more open and have actually a really pretty red center and are clearly five-petaled. This is a chestnut oak that's obviously been burned at the base, and you can just see the damage that it does. So now the base of the tree is exposed to different diseases, and you know, at some point this tree is going to succumb. It's already, you can see that it's already rotting out at the bottom, probably from fungal infection. So this shortens the lifespan of the tree. We've got some cool things here. This is, in fact, a blueberry, and there are a bunch of blueberries around me. They're kind of all over the place. And these have flowered, as I mentioned, in April, and now they're developing fruits. And the fruits are typically ready in July. They're edible. New York City actually has 3 different species of blueberries that all provide fruit. And they're native. They dry in these dry, oaky woods. And so these dry oaky woods are lovely. They also typically have really cool orchids and things if they're in really good shape. But no orchids in Inwood. This is Viburnum acerifolium, maple-leaved viburnum. You can see this looks a lot like maples. Back there, those flowered, and now they're turning into fruits as well. And fruit is just the name of the thing that comes after a flower. If something had a flower, then it has a fruit. Grasses in flower now will have fruits too. So fruit isn't just about being edible for people. Now you know botanical lingo. We also have right behind me here, this is a red maple. And red maples are commonly planted as street trees. They're also native to New York City. They're native, in fact, from Maine to Florida. So it's a really common native tree. And back behind, that is a witch hazel. And that's a pretty common shrub. It is very shade tolerant. So it always forms these beautiful arches because the leaves are setting themselves up perpendicular to the sun. And it creates this lovely V shape. Very pretty. And our native witch hazel actually flowers in October and November. It's not, the spring ones are usually the ones you find in botanic gardens, and those are Asian. But this native one flowers at a really unusual time of year, which makes it really special because it's one of the only things you'll find in flower in November. And over here, this is another red maple here. And this is an amelanchier right behind it, a Juneberry. You can see the Juneberry here the bark here. And this is not common in the city. It's a city rare shrub. It's a shrub because it lives underneath the bigger canopy trees. And there's more blueberry here, more blueberry here. And blueberries are great if you have a garden to plant. They're an all year round plant. They have beautiful red foliage in the fall, cute little flowers in the spring, and of course fruits in summer. But they're also great for caterpillars. It feeds about 200 different species of caterpillars, and birds eat caterpillars. So you're feeding birds and then you're creating beautiful butterflies. So it's a win for everybody. This is a Juneberry that has a really incredible richness of fruits on it. You can see just lots and lots of fruits, and they're turning red. They're not quite ripe to eat. But it's called Juneberry. Obviously, today is May 29th, and it's almost June, and the Juneberries are almost ready. So it's just a couple more weeks, and they're actually really delicious. And I do know that a lot of people like to forage for these fruits and eat them, which is great. But when you do things like that, you have to, if it's a native plant, especially one that's rare in the city like this is, you take a few for yourself, but then you always want to leave most of them for the birds and also for the plant to continue to reproduce. This is a nice patch of New York fern. So we wanted to stop and check this out. There is some poison ivy at my feet, but that's okay. And you can see it's a really bright green, how pretty it is. And ferns typically grow in two ways, either in clumps together, or they're stoloniferous and they just kind of run. And that's what New York fern is doing right now. It's just kind of running around and taking over this space. Here's Virginia creeper we talked about earlier, leaves of five, and it's growing up this tree. Again, woody vine. And just below at the base of the tree is poison ivy. This is maple leaf viburnum again. And here's sassafras again. And you can see all the different leaf shapes on it. And also that caterpillars have been eating it, so that's really awesome. And there's something else over here that's related to sassafras. And spicebush, this is spicebush. So the spicebush swallowtail caterpillar eats these leaves and these leaves. And if they don't have either of these, see all the awesome holes in there? If they don't eat them, if these aren't around, then they have nothing to eat. So it's really important to have these plants in the landscape. And again, these are in the same plant family, they're related. This is a really common shrub. And you roll the leaf up and you smell it, and it smells like citronella. It's an amazing smell, better than citronella. So that's why it's called spice bush, because the leaves are kind of spicy. And ooh, here's a baby tulip tree. You don't see seedlings of these very often. So tulip trees, we'll see more tulip trees as we walk, but here's a little seedling of it with these cute, funky leaves. Here's a green ash, and it has these little bumps on it. Whenever you look at a plant and you see something unusual on the leaf, chances are it's a gall, and a gall is an insect living inside the leaf of the plant. The insect secretes a chemical which makes the leaf do funky things. And in this case, it basically encloses them and gives them protection until the larvae mature and come out. So these are called ash leaf bullet galls. And I do not remember what's inside them, but if you Google it, Google will tell you. So you can look it up, but that's what these are, ash leaf bullet galls. And ashes are neat because they're opposite. So this whole thing is a leaf. And this whole thing is a leaf. So each individual leaf is actually a leaflet. So the leaves are opposite each other on the stem. So that's a really easy way to tell an ash, identify an ash. Here's something else with a compound leaf, pinnately compound. This is a hickory. This is bitternut hickory. You can tell because the early leaves and the buds on them are sulfur yellow. But this is not opposite on the trunk or the stem. So that's alternate and these are opposite, and that's how you can tell them apart. Another thing is just if you can see around where we are, that we're obviously lower than we were. So we're going down, down, and there's more and more shade. It also means there's more moisture. So we're having more moisture-loving plants like the spice bush and like the the red maple. So we're seeing more and more of those as we go lower and lower in elevation. Check out this beautiful flower. This didn't come from the ground, but it came from a tree. This is a tulip flower from a tulip tree. And you can see that it's just so cool looking. The petals of the flowers are three different colors. They're kind of sherbet colors. There's a tangerine and then a lime in the middle. And typically towards the tips, they're yellowish. This is a little bit of a creamy color. And this is part of, this is in the magnolia family, which is one of the oldest flowering families that we have. And so this was in flower in the time of the dinosaurs. So because these flowers are so evolutionarily old, they're also very simple. And what you see here is just lots and lots of male parts, the anthers here, and that's where the pollen comes out, and there's lots and lots of those. And this cone here is the female part. It looks like a cone. The leaf shape is something else that's really cool to see because this is very unusual. Maples, these are really four-lobed, one, two, three, four, and maples typically are five or three. Maples would have that one here. But this to me looks like someone who's parted their hair down the middle. That's how I think about it. So it's a very unusual leaf shape, and tulip trees, they're also called tulip poplars. They're the only ones that have that. We also found one that had the fruits on it. So this is what the fruit looks like. Here's that, the female part that's still there. And these are the seeds that would fly off, and typically they just kind of fall off. And it's kind of a woody looking thing. And there's a lot of angry squirrels behind us chattering. I don't know if you can hear them. There's a big tulip tree just behind us. Let's go take a look at this over here. And there are a lot of tulip trees in this park. They're really long lived. This one is a mature tulip tree. It's probably about 100 years old or so. And we know this because the bark tends to change over time. As the trees age, their bark ages as well. And it's developing this platy look down here. You can see that it's really different from that. And so that means that this is an old, mature tree. You can also just tell by its size. It's humongous. But tulip trees all have this kind of deep, grooved, and like really soft bark. Another good tell for the tulip tree is that it's super, super straight. And in fact, the Lenni Lenape, who are the native tribes that lived in Inwood Hill Park in Manhattan, used these trees for canoes because you could get one canoe out of a single trunk because they grew so straight and tall. And in fact, even in winter, it's such an easy way to identify the trees. You look at all the trees, most of them twist and turn looking for light, but tulip trees are always straight and tall. This is a black cherry. Black cherries are one of the most common native trees we have in the city. And in fact, the survey that the Brooklyn Botanic Garden did of the urban flora of New York City says that this is the most common tree, period. So one way to tell that this is a black cherry is by the bark. The bark has this kind of cornflakey look to it, where it looks like it's individual pieces kind of glued on, almost like a child's art project. And so that is a dead giveaway. The bark is really dark, as you can see. There's an interesting mix of herbaceous stuff over here. Herbaceous is what isn't woody. So it's things that have bendable stems, typically. And one of the most common wildflowers, also they're called, are Virginia jumpseed, which is this. It's a polygonum. So you can identify things in the polygonum family, buckwheat, because they have papery sheaths at their joints, which this definitely does. This also has kind of a cool chevron, which is, oh, here's a good one, a chevron here, which makes it pretty. And I've actually seen this in people's gardens in different neighborhoods in Brooklyn. So the horticultural trade definitely sells it. The flowers are not very exciting, but this is a native plant. You find it a lot along trails as you walk through. Here's another native. This is common blue violet, Viola sororia. This is the most common violet we have in the city. We've probably got about 12 different species of violets, but this is the most common. Violets are really important for fritillary butterflies. It's their only food source. So if you don't have violets, you're not feeding the fritillaries. So violets are good. Here's Virginia jumpseed. And one of the easiest ways to identify it is by this V-shaped chevron. It's purpley, sometimes it's dark green. Makes it really easy to identify. And just behind it, that's Solidago canadensis, or sorry, Solidago caesia, which is blue wreath goldenrod. And it's a shade tolerant goldenrod. Most people think of goldenrod as being sun loving, but this one does super in the shade. And it's really pretty. It has axillary flowers that come out where each one of the leaves branch off. So that'll be blooming later in the summer. And finally, we have what was called Eupatorium rugosum, but is now Azurotina altissima, because botanical taxonomists never take a break. But it is still called white snake root, the common name. It's also in the aster family, so it is related to goldenrod. And it has a white poof of flowers, that really good nectar source for lots of different insects. And this is very hardy. So if you're trying to restore a natural area, this is a really good plant to use. It's definitely not a good plant though for gardens, because it'll kind of take over. But I've also seen it growing in sidewalk cracks, so good plant. Here's Great Solomon Seal, and you can see why it's called great, because it's enormous, it's really tall. This is a wildflower that has congeners that are common in the city. So other species of Solomon Seal, hairy Solomon Seal, smooth Solomon Seal, but typically they're much shorter, they're down here. So this is much, much bigger. And this is in the lily family. So you'll see all of the veins run in the same direction. And lily family is common in our woodlands as understory species. They do well in the shade. And so the family as a whole, you'll find a lot of different wildflowers in the lily family. But this is definitely a city rare plant. We don't have many of these in the city, so this is a really cool find. Also, you know, it's enormous. And right now it's really beautiful with the sun shining on it. You can see the iridescence of the leaves. And there are clusters of flowers dangling underneath. So this is a wild flower. These are actually still in bud, so you can't really see them. One is just opening down over here. And the flowers themselves are not that exciting. They're kind of a greenish white color. But it's just a really beautiful, striking plant. And this is something, Solomon Seal, that you tend to see in the horticultural trade. People have them in their gardens. Here we're looking at a red oak. You can see the bark is really distinctive. It has this ski slopey effect where there are darker and lighter shades of gray that kind of swoosh in and out between each other. And that's a really good indicator of red oaks. So you can identify them from a distance, even if you can't see the leaves. That bark is very distinctive. And it gets more furrowed and platier the further down the trunk you get, because that's the older part of the tree. So you always want to scan the whole tree and look at different parts of the trunk before you do an identification. Also, the leaves are very distinctive. We have, here's a leaf, you can see them up there too, but really pointy at the end, multi-lobed. Red oak, one of the most common trees we have in our forests. And a really good, good tree for beneficial wasps. They like to make galls in oaks and then go around and parasitize other insects. So oaks are a really good food tree for insects. These flowers are maple leaf viburnum. We saw this when we were further up at the top of the outcrop. And here we have just a little cluster that's still in flower. Most of them have already flowered and are already working on making fruits. This is a shade-tolerant shrub. It's common in the city. And the leaves do look like maple leaves, but it never gets to be as tall as a maple. Also, these leaves are really furry. But it turns beautiful, kind of bluish-purple foliage in the fall. So it's a really nice plant to use in gardens if you have room for it. This is the only salt marsh left in Manhattan. It's in Inwood Hill Park, so now we're at the bottom of and the end of our tour. And salt marshes used to be much more common in New York City, and approximately 95% of the city's salt marshes have been filled. Basically because salt marshes are coastal, they're typically in protected coastal areas, and a lot of New York City's edges have been lost to commerce, so filled and made ports. So this is a restored marsh, so it's not quite what it was originally in its splendor, but there are still a lot of salt marsh plants here, which are really good to know and see. So we've got Spartina alternifera. In fact, I'm gonna hop over there. We've got Spartina alternifera, which is this grass down here. And this gets inundated once a day. You can see this is low tide. So the water that's typically in here has receded and it's out towards the Hudson River and the Spuyten Duyvil and the Harlem River, all of them connect right over there, and then it'll flood back in. So this is a lot of thick muck. We've got Spartina, and Spartina lives in this salty area. You'll see little salt crystals on the edge of its leaves. So that's kind of neat. We've got marsh elder. This is a shrub that you see in salt marshes. And it grows just up out of the influence of the tide. So the Spartina is inundated, but these shrubs typically just kind of get their feet wet. Here's something else. This is Solidago sempervirens. Sempervirens meaning long-lived, and called that because it tends to be evergreen, or mostly evergreen, evergreen-ish. And it's a goldenrod, so seaside goldenrod. And it's one of the most beautiful goldenrods. I love it because the little individual flowers are so big. Typically in goldenrods, they're really small. And it's such a pretty optimistic shade of yellow. It's really nice. And what else do we have over here? Something here. This is marshmallow, the seeds of marshmallow. Really big tropical looking flowers. And this is a perennial, so this is all last year's flowering stalks. And there's little green buds down at the base that they're just starting to shoot up now. So this is all growing back. And soon enough, it'll be up and flowering again. And you can see in the background, that's the Henry Hudson Bridge. So the Henry Hudson Bridge connects Manhattan, which is on the left, to the Bronx, which is on the right. And just beyond the Henry Hudson Bridge, that you can kind of get a sneak peek at is New Jersey and the Palisades. And between New York City and New Jersey is the Henry Hudson River. So that's what we're looking out onto right now. And this seems like a good place to end our tour. thank you so much for coming out with us. We hope you enjoyed it, and hopefully you'll get to come to Inwood Hill Park one day on your own in person and enjoy all of this up close and personal. Thanks for supporting the Kickstarter campaign.